We love you. We appreciate you. We reference you. We thank you for this new month. We thank you to those, the first Sunday of the month. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor and adoration. Eyes have not seen, ear have not heard. Neither has it entered the heart of man what you, God, has predestinated for us. But by eyes of faith, we receive them with thanksgiving. We are expectant. We want to see your move in the sanctuary. Have your way. Let burdens be lifted up. Let you be broken in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Delight in us, O Lord, and in what we believe and what we stand for. That in return you will compensate, you will reward us mightily. In the name of Jesus. As we go into your word, Lord, we pray that you give us understanding about your word. Thank you, righteous Father. In Jesus' name we pray. And the church of God will say,
amen.
Praise God. Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received and in which you stand. It was a letter of Apostle Paul to the church in Corinth. Now, the church in Corinth was struggling with a lot of things in this period. And the prominent and profound one at this particular time of his writing that he addressed was their unbelief that there will be resurrection. They don't believe that there will be life after death. So Apostle Paul dedicated chapter 15 of the book of 1 Corinthians to address this issue. But he started by his belief and conviction that Christ who called us was the incarnate God who came in human form, lived with us for 33 and a half years, and died. And after that, he was buried. Buried in the tomb as he predicted while he was on earth. And after 3 days, he resurrected. After he resurrected, he ascended to heaven. And he released his Holy Spirit unto us in the day of Pentecost. And now we don't need to have a physical incarnate God. But we have the Spirit of God in us, believers who accepted Christ as their Lord and personal Savior. If you agree with me, please, that will help me. We're dealing with the power of the new church. We're dealing with the power of new believers. We're dealing with the power of Christians. You don't need any other thing except the name of Jesus Christ. You don't need any other God, so to say, except the name of Jesus Christ. We're using the Acts of Apostles to establish our faith in Christ. We see other churches. We read a lot of books about the generals who did miracles, signs, and wonders in their own time and generation. But we are stuck in our own generation wondering, pondering, what are we doing wrongly? Where are no more great evangelists? There are no more revivers in our own time. We are struggling. So what we do is to be trapped in our opinion. Thinking when we pray, prayer can be answered or cannot be answered. If God answers my prayer, I give testimony. If he doesn't answer my prayer, I wait until when he answers prayer. We don't even know convincingly that God answers prayer anymore. We don't believe in miracle anymore. So when we see one miracle out of million, we stand in awe with our jaw dropping. Wow! Is the man of God using voodoo or witchcraft? Because we don't believe. We don't believe anymore. And once there is no expectation, it's likened to a fire of coal, a coal of fire that is taken out of the fire. It's a matter of time the fire will be put off. Once there is no expectation, once you don't believe that there is miracle, there will never be miracle. Praise God. So Apostle Paul started by saying, moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preach to you, which also you receive and in which you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preach to you, unless you believe in vain. Unless you believe in vain. If you have believed in the word I have been preached to you, and the word is simply about the gospel. The gospel is Jesus Christ. If you believe in him, his existence, then you are saved. That's what the Bible says. John 3:16-17. For God loved the world so much that he gave us his only begotten son. And whosoever believed in him will not die, but what they will have. Once you believe, you are saved. That is the gospel. The gospel is about Jesus Christ, the incarnate God who came and died for mankind. That's it. But we want to go further after our belief, after our confession. What do we do with our faith in him? What do? We have to let the world know. We have to let the world know about the gospel. It will be a disservice on Jesus Christ if you believe in him and you are saved and you keep quiet about that testimony. It will be a disservice. It is an injustice to the unsaved. Oh. I said it here last week. If you have been in need, you will cherish when you have. I take it again. If you have ever been marginalized or oppressed, you will appreciate freedom. You are still not responding with me. If you have ever been hated in any form, when people commend you, you will appreciate it. Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. Apostle Paul was one of those that persecuted the church who hated Jesus Christ so much that he was out to kill the believers. He was actually on his way to arrest and sent to jail the believers in Damascus when God, if I can use that word, arrested him. He was not really arrested, but God called him. But you hear from a lot of people that God arrested Paul. God did not arrest Paul. But God caught him on his way, even in that evil act and intention. For the Bible says God searched the heart and weighed every action. God knew he was on his way to persecute him. And God called him, struck him with lightning. He fell down. He was hearing from God. People around him, as wicked as he was, he asked his own disciple. They did not hear what God was saying, but he was hearing what God was saying. And from then, his story changed. He was brought to the council of the elders. He was rejected in Jerusalem. They said, no, this was the one that was the chief among the church persecutors. We can't bring him here. They despise him because of what he has done. But he was ready to put his blood online for this same gospel. He was ready to die, not only to preach. See, for me, to die for the gospel is gain, then I will be with the Lord. See, but I will live for him. I will live for him. I will live for Jesus Christ, for the gospel. And here we go. Why? Because he has been without. Oh, no. He has been without the knowledge of God. He has been on the other side. And now that he has been transformed to this new side, he can't keep quiet. Where are the evangelists of our time? Where are the selfish men and women of God in the house? You don't appreciate what God has done for you if you are quiet about his grace upon your life. Thank God, Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15:10 that the faith that he had in Christ, the grace of God that brought him this far, is not in vain. Is the grace in your life in vain? Why are you keeping quiet? Why are you keeping quiet about him, about his grace, about his love, his compassion? Why are you keeping quiet? Thank God, the grace of God upon my life is not in vain. He's ready to die for the gospel. The power of the new church, the power. Evangelism. Evangelism is just simply sharing with those who are without the gospel of Jesus Christ. Simple. Sharing with those that are without the gospel of Jesus Christ. You don't need to have passed or been to any seminary school before you can be a witness. Hello? I know many of us are intimidated. We say, let's go to evangelism. No, Pastor, I'm not an evangelist. All you need to do is just so, here I am, Lord. Here I am, Lord. Send me. Here I am, Lord. If there's any church that will strive greatly in at this end time period, it must be a church that engage in pragmatic evangelism. Did you hear what I just said? The reason why you see the church's numbers dwindling down is because all what we are doing is just recycling, transferring of somebody from one church to another church. And we are happy on Sunday. We clap our hand. And the pastor, missus, and pastors going to Christian. What church are you going? Don't you know that pastor? No, come to our pastor. That's what we're doing. That's what we're doing. And souls are out there that are waiting for your testimony. How you were saved. That's all they need. They don't need to know your pastor. Don't tell anybody about pastor. I'm nothing. Tell them about how you have been saved. What difference has Christ made in your life since you have become a Christian? That is what somebody out there is waiting for. I was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I can see. What an amazing grace. What an amazing grace. What an amazing grace. The grace is given to you, it's on you. The grace is on me. The grace is on us. Jesus Christ is residing in us. That's all what the world are waiting to hear from us. It's not about the Bentleys and the Rolls Royce that your pastor parked in front of his church. That is not what saved people. That's not what saved people. They want to know your testimony. Your testimony. I have been without, but now he is with me. I can sleep comfortably without no fear. I've told you anywhere, my door is open. FBI, CIA, please be my guest. I will offer you wine. And you know our wine? Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. Brothers and sisters, this is a testing period for the church. And when I mean by church, I mean the church of Christ. It's coming for one church. I'm not talking about denomination now. And all the doctrines that are divided, the church and the churches. It's coming for one church. Let's engage in evangelism. Let's engage. People are waiting out there. There are many that are struggling coming to church on a Sunday because of our attitudes. Even Christians. If your attitude has sent people out of the church, how do you think you're going to win souls to the church? Praise God. The doctrine of Christ's death and resurrection is the foundation of Christianity. You can write it down. Without his death and resurrection, there is no Christianity. Write it down. I want to probe your mind this morning. We dwell so much on this month, and I want us to be able to move forward a little bit. All true Christians believe that Jesus Christ and him crucified and then risen from the dead is the sum and substance of Christianity. The sun there is not the sun as a sun now, it's a sunlight now. All Christians, true believers, believe that Jesus Christ and him crucified and then risen from the dead is the sum and substance of Christianity. If you doubt that or you don't believe that, you are not yet, even if you profess him to be your God, you are not part of him. You're not part of him. Thirdly, all the apostles agreed in this very testimony. By this faith they lived, and in this faith they died. Christ died before all of them. But they carry on the mandate because they believe. He died for them. They will die for him out of conviction. And I believe many of us in our comfort zone, even we not saying it generally that we don't want to die for Christ, when we're asking you, let's go for evangelism, pastor, my daughter, my son, you are just telling her it doesn't even worth dying for. That's what we're saying it rightly. You prefer to do time and a half than being on the field, the mission field, to let people know that, listen, there is a way that is out there for you, the way of salvation. We're telling Jesus Christ, yes, I believe you died for me, but I don't think I can die for you. That's what we're doing. Whenever we choose the pleasure of the world, wherever we appreciate the pleasure of the world than what Christ did for us, we have just told him, Master, I believe in you, but I can't die for you. The irony of this is that the unbelievers are looking at us. They are looking at us. It was just few individuals who said, you know what, in New York City, where money makes everything, but when it comes to Saturday, on the Sabbath day, we who believe in the Mosaic, we don't want to work. I believe they gathered together, they reasoned together, and they protested. Now, they don't go to work on their Saturday when they worship their God. It's become a law. Okay? But now, you will work on Saturday. When it comes to Sunday, they will compel you, mandate you to be at work on your Sunday. And because they have no voice against it, and they will give you incentive. Okay, you come on Sunday, we give you a little bit of, and you sit down because of money. because of money, undermining that someone died for your freedom. Undermining that someone died for your freedom. And you say you love him. How can you show him you love him if you would rather take the pleasure of the world than turning your back against the world? How are you showing the world that you really love him? What does it mean to you? What does it mean to us? People have been on this journey before. They didn't rely on anything. At their risk, they stood for the gospel. Some were beheaded. They were asked, renounce Jesus so you live or die. They chose to die. The first martyr, Stephen, at his point of death, when he was being stoned to death, Bible says he was praying, Lord, forgive them, for they knew not what they were doing. He was not begging them to spare his life. For this gospel, I will die, but I would rather pray for you all, for you don't know what you're doing. It's out of conviction. If you don't believe there is life after this, then you are not a Christian. If all you think is about the pleasure of the world, the houses, the cars, your son and daughter, husband, wife, children, that's all what you care about in this world. Oh, it is my prayer that the Lord will help you to have a better understanding. It's good to have it. God said, seek ye for the kingdom of God. First, he said, Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and every other thing will be given unto you. Every other thing will be given unto you. There is no one who ever forsake anything for God on this earth and the earth to come, that God will not reward. That is his word. He could not swear by anything. He sworn by his own name. He's not a liar. He's not a liar. Believe in him. You can't be a Christian and doubt the word of God that you are not a Christian. Believe in what it says. Search the scripture. Hold on to the scripture. Live by the scripture. Let the scripture direct your pathway. It's not, doctrine is not going to save us. It has never saved. The apostolic father did not preach doctrine. They preach Jesus, who was crucified and resurrected. That's it. That's it. Miracles were performed. Unbelievers were in awe. The apostle father challenged them. Why are you men standing in awe? Don't you know the same Christ you crucified? He's the one that had just done this. He's the same one. They were not sharing the glory. He has ascribed the glory unto him who died and resurrected. People are waiting for our testimony. Your family members are waiting. Oh. Your children are waiting on your testimony. They are watching you. What you say, what you do, they are watching. They are hearing, they are listening, they are seeing it. The world is waiting on us to be truthful to our faith and believe. They want to change, but they want to see you. Our actions have to match what we profess. Thank God we all woke up on the 9th of November, and we all were like, really? The 21st of January? Really? And since then, really? Yeah, it's real. It's real. We are waiting. We are all seeing it. If you can't stand for anything, you will fall for everything. If you can't stand for something, we fall for everything. What are you standing for? What are we standing for? Church, what are we standing for? Are we really people of faith? Are we really people of faith? Oh my goodness. We can do better than this one. Christ, the gospel of Christ is known to bring division into humanity. It's a gospel of peace and love. I find it very hard for me to comprehend that someone says, because of Christian, I'm doing this. I find it very, I don't want to use the word offensive because it's our president. And this is not a platform to speak about politicals, but I have the right to make my own view known. I have the right. So you do have your own right. But somebody is not fighting for me in this. Let your good work be known, be seen, so that the unbeliever, the unsaved, when they see the good work, they're going to attribute your goodness to your Father in heaven. That is what God says. That's what God says. All authority are ordained by God. No doubt about it. But Bible says righteousness is sought in nature, but sin is a reproach. It's a reproach. Stigma. Blemish. That's what sin does. It caused the mighty to fall. We will not fall in Jesus' name. We are not commanded to force Christianity or Christian values and views or standards upon the unbelieving world. We are not forced. Look at your Bible, 1 Corinthians 5:12. 1 Corinthians 5:12. Let me give you this one. If you're writing it down, we're not meant to force our view or our values on unbelievers. You scare them away from you. The gospel of Jesus Christ goes all peace. 1 Corinthians 5:12 says, "For what have I to do with judging those also who are outside? Do you not judge those who are inside?" God has not called us to judge those who are not Christians. If you judge unbeliever, what about quote unquote so called believer? Huh? What are we doing today? We are not called to judge, but to let the world know about the peace, the love, the outstanding, astonishing love, grace that is upon the name of Jesus Christ and what he stands for. I would say he despised all the chained when he had the authority to call on the host of heaven to defend him. He did not. He told Peter, "Sheathe your sword. Don't you know whoever killed by sword will die by sword?" He brought the ear that was ripped off, gave me the ear, and he placed it back. So I can call the legions of the host of heaven, and they will come and take over. I said, but no. See a lot of messages coming to my WhatsApp. Some I just delayed. Brothers and sisters. For many of us from African, many that have experienced war, do you ever pray to experience war again? Many of you who came from war-torn environment, do you ever in your lifetime pray that war will ensue anywhere where you are? Ah, may the Lord help us in Jesus' name. Just national tragedy. Just national tragedy. We have seen how he has separated, ripped lives apart. Talk less of war. War. Chemical weapons in the hand of some disgruntled individuals. Do you know what havoc they can wreak with it? I hate your God, and I have chemical weapons. Do you know what chemical weapon is? We all breathe. We are living by breath. And once you inhale it, you can't exhale it. It's going to destroy your organ, chop you down, die instantly once there is no oxygen in your system. Prayer, let's go on our knees and pray. I know people have right to protest. This is not time to protest. 4 years is minus. 4 years is minus already. Let the politicians group themselves. If they don't like what Trump is going to do for 4 years, let them regroup themselves and get their next 4 years. But don't let us destroy what we have now. Let me leave there. The Lord help us in Jesus' name. We are not to confuse people by allowing them to believe that church membership, tithing, or any good works are somehow connected with becoming a Christian. I take that again. We are not to confuse people by allowing them to believe that church membership, tithing, sowing seed, or any good work of any sort in the church are somehow connected with becoming a Christian. It is not so. So Ephesians 2 from verse 8 to 9 says that you all know that salvation is a gift of God. Your tithe, your offering, your good work, church attendance does not save you. Do we all agree? When the trumpet will sound, it is my prayer that we will not be found wanting in Jesus' name. If God say my judgment will stand from the pulpit, I have no doubt that many will, as he said in Matthew 25, say many will say, I do miracle in your name. He say, you are workers of iniquity. Get to hell. It will start from the pulpit. Those who manipulate church members, shepherds who slaughter flocks, slaughter sheep to eat, they will account for it. Why you not say amen? Say amen in Jesus' name. So we should not pray that if you pay the highest bid, your salvation is guaranteed. That's a wrong doctrine. It's a wrong doctrine. We are not called for that. Salvation is free. Amen. We have not worked for it, and no man will ever work for it. No amount of work can equate to the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are talking about he who died and resurrected. It was not an apostolic father who gave us Christianity and salvation. No, it was Christ alone who died. It's not your pastor, not your mother, not your father. Salvation is in the name of the Lord. Thank you, Lord. We have only one thing to share with the unsaved, and that is the gospel of Christ. That's the only thing. According to Paul, it involves the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That is just the gospel. His birth, the immaculate conception, the birth, the miraculous birth of him, his death, the painful, excruciating, painful death, and his resurrection, his miraculous resurrection. Because that is where the death of the gospel is anchored, his resurrection. Buddha died, never. Muhammad died, never. Jesus Christ died. But the third day, he rose again from dead. That is the difference. That is just the difference. That is just the difference. That is what the world are waiting on you to hear. They want to hear from you. And he's coming very soon, not as a lamb, but as a lion. And he's coming to judge his church. It is my prayer when he comes. and we find you worthy in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Now, in letting the world know about our faith in Christ, which is the way of evangelism, we have to preach to them through the word of God. What does the word of God says about Christian religion, if you want to call it, because many of us think it's a religion. Many say it's a way of life, it's a philosophy, whatever you want to call it. But we have a standard. We have a standard. We have a principle that guides our faith in Christ. And the principle is established, well orchestrated, written down in the Bible. So whatever you want to say to an unsaved or so-called unbeliever, please don't preach out of your ignorance. Oh, my pastor said this. That's out of ignorance. That's out of ignorance. Let it be from the word of God. You don't need to know Genesis or Revelation. You don't need to. Any word, if you don't have any word, just tell them, I've been going to church. I've been listening. I've been hearing. And I believe. You want to know the word of God? Come and ask my pastor a question. Praise the Lord. God's word says all sinners are condemned to hell. It is in the word of God. We have all sinned and come short of God's glory. Romans 3, 10 and 23. Those who have not believed in Christ, we go to eternal damnation. Hellfire. That's the word of God. You can let them know, they might believe, they might not believe it, but the principles that guide your faith has established this, open it unto them. Why should I? Let them know. It is not discussion that will scare them, but this is what the word of God says. Are we together? Are we together? Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. There is nothing a lost person can do on his own to save himself. A lost person, someone who is lost, there is no how they can ever save themselves. Isaiah 64 verse 6. The book of prophet Isaiah 64 verse 6. Someone that is lost is lost. But we are all like an unclean thing, and all our unrighteousness are like filthy rags. We all fade as a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind have taken us away. Because we are in our filthy nature, we are likened to that leaf that is being blown away by the wind. We have no destiny, no destination. We're not ourselves. So someone who is trapped in negative opinion or mindset or belief system does not know they are trapped. They are locked or boxed up in their mind, believing in what they believe and think that's the best in the right thing that they should believe in. Until when something better is introduced to them, they will remain in who they are. And it is not about condemnation. You can't condemn it because you don't know better. If you were condemned when you were not a Christian, how will you get out of your own self-trapped opinion? It was the grace of God that was extended to you. It could be someone who, a family member, or perhaps a revival was going in your neighborhood, and you managed to go there, and you hear the word of God, and then your mind opened to the light. So that brother, that sister that you are condemning is waiting for such an opinion and such an opportunity. Praise God. Praise the living Jesus. Write it down. Christ was born, crucified, and resurrected to save lost people from their sin. Is the essence. The reason why he came was to come and save the lost. Christ was born, crucified, and resurrected to save lost people of their sin. John 3:16. 1 Timothy 1:15. To be saved, a sinner must believe God's word and invite Christ into his heart by faith. That's what we call an altar call. You have unbelievers who are in the house, they don't believe. And they have opportunity to be convicted. John 3:16, 1 Timothy 1:15. To be saved, a sinner must believe God's word and invite Christ into his heart by faith. John 5:24. I want to run through this one for the next 5 minutes before we round up. I want to raise up some evangelists in this church. Amen. We are all called to this assignment. We all. And we are falling short of it. In order to share your faith with unbelievers successfully, you must keep the following rules in mind. First, you must be a clean vessel. You must write it down. You must be a clean vessel. It's called the law of content. You can't give what you don't have. Many of us profess to be Christian, but our attitude, our actions say something different. So when you're talking to people, they're looking at you and say, really, you? I don't think I want to serve your God. We must be clean. Must be a clean vessel for God to be used. David the sinner prays for forgiveness and cleansing. In the book of Psalm 51, we all know the story of how he went to Beersheba and the wife of Uriah, killed Uriah in the war soon so that he can. But he cried unto the Lord in Psalm 51. And he said, then if God first, he said, upon, when he said, David, the sinner prays for forgiveness and cleansing, he said, upon receiving the forgiveness from Christ, he said, then Lord, I will teach the sinners. I will teach the unrighteous, the unsaved, your ways. Because I have been without you, but now you have shown me your grace. I will go and tell them. Anytime you fall short of God's glory, anytime you sin, go on your knees, repent of your sin, we're serving a loving God. That was why the Apostle Paul did great exploit in bringing unbelievers to Christ, because he had been without. He was not sitting upon the grace. He was not saying, wow, thank God I'm saved. This is good enough for me. Say, no, you show this mercy to me. There are millions out there. I will die for them. Praise the Lord. God might not be asking for or demanding for a golden silver vessel, but he placed a request on a clean vessel. And desire to be worn so they can use you. It's said to be a clean vessel so they can use it. We must be able to clearly give out the simple facts of the gospel. This is very essential that I've been screaming since morning. Many of us think, no, I don't know how to, unless I have tract in my hand, I can't go out and evangelize. Come on. What do we need to do in the days of the apostle? There was no pen and paper. There was nothing. No notebook. It was the message they heard from Christ that changed them, and the same message they convey to the unsaved. People are waiting on your testimony. They are waiting to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ from you. Not the... Help us in Jesus' name. We must avoid argument and stick to the basic issues of men's sins and Christ's blood. Let's avoid argument. You're going to find some out there who will ask you, just like I was in my own days, okay, God created heaven and earth. Who created God? I was stuck on that question when I was an unbeliever. Who created God? You say I should serve him, believe in him. But who made him? Who is his mother? Who is his father? See what ignorance does? I was trapped and I was fighting. Each time they preach gospel, I would tell them, who created your God? So when you see people arguing that way, please don't raise your voice. Avoid argument. Some can ask you, okay, Cain, after Cain left God, so where did he get a wife? You heard that question before? Who is Cain's wife? Where did his wife come from? Because he went away from the presence of God and there were no many of them. So where did he get a wife from? Did we ask? Listen, those questions does nothing to you. It does nothing to you. Oh, when was Christ born? So how come they are celebrating Christmas? Please avoid that. That is irrelevant. Either he was born on a Tuesday, on a Monday, or August, or it does not matter. Don't believe he was born one day. Whatever two of you agree on, God say, we agree with it. It will be established in heaven. Don't evangelize based on argument. Use simple facts and truth that you know. If anybody is telling you, say, oh, please, I haven't studied theology to that level. I'm not a doctorate. Just avoid them. Don't go doing research and tell them, okay, let's meet next week. And you start go and be digging and digging and digging. You don't need to act. Don't defend God. Hallelujah. Praise God. We must use the word of God at all times. Paul's tremendous success as an evangelist can be linked directly to his constant use of God's word. God's word over and over. Acts 17:2. You see right there. And all right, finally, we must depend upon the Spirit of God in evangelizing the world. The essence of all this is for us to pick up ourselves from where we are. And look at that brother, that sister who is struggling in faith. Don't let us push them down, but let's encourage them to lift them up. We have been down, but Christ reached out unto us and lifted us up. You are meant to go out there and lift up others. That is the essence of our calling. That is the duty of the new church. Even as we do that as a church, the Lord increases us, the Lord blesses us, and the Lord establishes us in Jesus' name. Let's stand on our feet. Thank you for clapping. Thank you for clapping. But don't forget, it's an assignment. As you go out of here, reach out to that brother, the sister that was not in church today. Reach out to them, the brother that was not in church today. Let them know God loves them. God loves them. God loves them tremendously. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. We bless you. We appreciate you for who you are and for what you are. We thank you for what you have done through your word. Even as we rededicate our body, spirit, and soul unto you, we receive your word with all grace. And we pray that that grace will work through us, O Lord, in the name of Jesus. Enlarge your church. Increase your church. Enlarge your people, O Lord, in the name of. Let the light of your word shine in our pathway. We offer you thanks and praises. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's stretch forth our hands this hour and begin to bless the man of God. Let's ask that the Lord God revitalize him. Let the Lord continue to reveal himself unto him. Let's ask that the Lord shield him, protect him. Let's ask that the scepter upon his life will not be stripped away. Let's begin to talk to God corporately. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, we rededicate and recommit.